Well, good morning. Almost. Everybody find their way to their seat. Good morning. Good to have everybody here this morning. Man alive, got a good crowd this morning. I know some of you are probably like, wow, the church is different. Yes, I did set the seats up different. Of course, you guys dashed my hopes of people wanting to sit in the middle and the wings are full first, but it's okay. I knew that would happen. I'm glad you're here. I hope you're glad you're here, man. Thankful for our visitors. We have first-time visitors here today. I love first-time visitors, but the one thing I love more than first-time visitors is second-time visitors. So glad to have them here, too, and glad to have some old family members here, some foreign family members here. Man, just a good crowd today. So let's start off with a word of prayer, okay? Dear gracious Heavenly Father, Lord God Almighty, I'm asking you, Lord, to do what only you can this morning, Lord. This is your house, Lord. These are your people. Lord, this is your time, and I pray, Lord, that you'd help us to fix our hearts on you, Lord, to allow you to do what only you can, Lord, using your spirit, using your word, Lord. And Lord, as we were learning about the work of the Holy Spirit this morning in Sunday school, Lord, Lord, we need that work today, Lord. We need it in our hearts, Lord. We need you, Lord, to breathe life into these old dead souls, Lord, and allow us, Lord, to just be drawn closer to you today. Lord, you know each heart here. Lord, you know those that may be here without Christ, God. I pray that today they would see their need for Jesus and that, Lord, you would gloriously meet that need as only you can. Lord, I pray for those that have called on Christ that are here and, Lord, maybe just need to strengthen that relationship with you. Lord, I pray, Lord, you'd help us to see that need and, Lord, allow you to draw us closer to you, Lord. Lord, I ask all this, Lord, and promise to give you the praise and the glory. And in Jesus' name, amen. All right, why don't everybody go ahead and stand. And we're going to start off this morning with Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone. Where would you be if not for the grace of God today? Amen. Well, that was kind of half-hearted. I'm just going to be honest with you, okay? That sounded half-hearted. I'm going to give you another chance because, see, it's not God's somewhat okay grace. That's not worth singing. That's not how the words go. This is God's amazing grace. So isn't God's grace really amazing to you today? I mean, that's a little bit better. Now let's sing this. Let's not just look at the words on the wall and sing them, but let's ponder that grace and what it's done, what God has done, his works have done in our life, and let's praise him for it right now. But go ahead, Brother Mark.
Saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Was grace that taught my heart. How precious did
Ushers, let's make the offering envelopes available. While they're doing that, I'm asking Pastor Brewer to come and give us announcements. Now pay attention, there's some things coming up you might want to listen so you don't miss out.
All right, good morning. Good to see such a good crowd this morning. Praise the Lord for that. Announcements. Last week's offering was $1,809.19 out of the needed $2,200. So we did not make budget last week, so keep praying for that. We did make our missions offering budget of about $146, so praise the Lord for that. Tonight is Birthday Sunday. Birthday Sunday. That means we're going to have cake. All right, so please join us this evening after the service. We'll be celebrating birthdays. We've got Miss Mary, Miss Sue, Miss Doris, Brother Curtis, and Miss Jenny. So come celebrate their birthdays with us tonight. If you want to bring along some snacks to go along with that, Miss Donna brings a great cheese ball, so we always love that. Then we have coming up on Sunday, October the 7th, during our PM service, we'll be having a movie night, which is Courageous, a very good movie. I think you'll be blessed by it. We'll have some popcorn around, so you can have that while you watch the movie. And then Sunday, October the 14th, we'll have the Kelly family with us. They are missionaries to the nation of Suriname. They're sent from Calvary Road. Some of you know who Brother Mike Kleitz is. He comes and does our Friend Sunday. So we'll be interested to hear what the Lord has planned for them. And then on Saturday, October the 20th, we will have Miles Pike in concert, and that's going to be at 4 o'clock. 4 o'clock, the time got changed a little bit, so please be aware of that. It's going to be at 4 o'clock. And then also, don't forget, all services are streamed on Facebook, so you can watch there if you have to be absent, or you can catch up with us at faithbaptist.us. Gentlemen, if you'll come forward, we'll receive the offering. All right. Brother Fred, will you lead us in prayer for the offering?
Thank you, Father, for this opportunity to be in your house this morning. We pray for the service, Lord, that you have a good day. Thanks for the food. And as you do the pastor,
amen. All right. Let's everybody go ahead and stand again. Now, we're about to sing my favorite hymn. This is it. This is my favorite hymn. I know there's a lot of people that call this one their favorite hymn. I love this one. This was a challenging hymn because it asked the question, really, even though it's saying it is well, but before we sing it, I mean, we can fool ourselves, can't we, into thinking that everything's all right between us and God. We lie to ourselves thinking that we're okay right where we're at. But this question kind of helps us to focus on the fact that we need to make sure that it is well with Him. I'm so thankful for this song. So thankful for the man. If you ever get a chance, you ought to look up the history of this song and the man that wrote it and what he was going through when he wrote this song. He wrote this song at the darkest time in his life, and he was able to say in the worst circumstances he could have ever been in, it is well. So let's sing this morning. Let's sing this, hoping that we can make things right with God today. Amen. Go ahead, Brother Mark.
Thank you.
and y'all can be seated. Miss Larissa, come on up. Church, I'm going to ask you to go ahead and head out the hallway there. My daughter, I think, is there waiting on you. And then I'll ask the rest of you all to please stand as you're opening your Bibles to Jonah chapter 3. Jonah chapter 3. This morning we're in the third part of our What If Giving Up Isn't an Option. Lord willing, we'll do the final part this evening at service tonight. But Jonah chapter 3, let's read what the word of God says. And the word of the Lord came unto Jonah the second time, saying, Arise, go unto Nineveh, that great city, and preach unto it the preaching that I bid thee. So Jonah arose and went unto Nineveh, according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceeding great city of 3 days' journey. And Jonah began to enter into the city a day's journey, and he cried and said, Yet 40 days, and Nineveh shall be overthrown. So the people of Nineveh believed God, and proclaimed a fast, and put on sackcloth, from the greatest of them even to the least of them. For word came unto the king of Nineveh, and he arose from his throne, and he laid his robe from him, and covered him with sackcloth, and sat in ashes. and he caused it to be proclaimed and published through Nineveh by decree of the king and his nobles, saying, Let neither man nor beast, herd nor flock, taste anything. Let them not feed nor drink water. But let man and beast be covered with sackcloth and cry mightily unto God. Yea, let them turn every one from his evil way and from the violence that is in their hands. Who can tell if God will turn and repent and turn away from his fierce anger, that we perish not? And God saw their works, and they turned from their evil way, and God repented of the evil that he had said that he would do unto them, and he did it not. Dear gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, I ask you, Lord, to just help me this morning, Lord, to step aside, Lord, to get out of your way so that you might have your way, Lord. I pray, Lord, as we look at this time and the life of this this man, Jonah, Lord, that you'd help us, Lord, to see what you would have us glean from that. And then, Lord, as we look to the people of Nineveh, God, I pray, Lord, that we would, Lord, look and see how what they did changed your view and their lives, Lord. But I'm asking, Lord, to help us to just allow you to work in our hearts and our lives this morning, Lord. I pray, God, that no one would hinder the Holy Spirit this morning from doing what only the Holy Spirit can do. Lord, and if there's anyone here again, Lord, that does not know Jesus Christ as their personal Savior, I pray that today, God, they would see that need and allow you to meet that need, Lord. Lord, we ask it all in the only name that gives us any credence, in Jesus' name, amen. Thank you so much. You can be seated. We've looked at the first two chapters of Jonah while trying to answer this question. What if giving up isn't an option? In chapter one, we looked at Jonah trying to give up on God's will for his life. We saw the mariners there in the boat with him that he was taking to the Tarshish, and they struggled to give up on their gods, on their works, and on their morals. But when they finally did give up, they found that God's grace was there in salvation for them. We also found out that Jonah, while he wanted to give up, it wasn't an option. God wasn't done with him. In chapter 2, we looked at Jonah, who took 3 days and three nights to finally come to the conclusion that he wasn't going anywhere, that God wasn't done with him, and he decided finally to pray. The first time we see Jonah pray in the entire book of Jonah is after he had spent those 3 days and nights in the belly of the whale. But finally he did give up on his will and give in to God's will to go to the people of Nineveh and go and preach as God had told them, told him to do. Now we come to chapter 3. This is God's second chance for Jonah. Praise God that he is the God of second and third and fourth and fifth and on chances. Amen? Amen? He's been so gracious, and Jonah is definitely one that can testify of the grace and the mercy and the long-suffering of God. So he decides to go do what God had commanded, but Jonah still has some obstacles in his life, both personal and physical, to overcome as he seeks to do God's will. And that's kind of what we're going to look at today, that and the people of Nineveh this morning. First, we see that Jonah receives God's word for the second time. You know, God has had to come to me and tell me several times what he's wanting me to understand. Has that been your case? Has that ever been your case? You don't have to raise your hand. But in your heart, how many times does it take God to get you to pay attention? Amen? But thank God he is that God of second chances. So Jonah receives God's word the second time, and it's not much different. He says, arise. He wants Jonah to get up. Now, thank God we have prayer. Amen? Okay, maybe not. I don't know. I'm thankful for prayer. Prayer is where I get to unload. Okay? You mean we get to unload on God? Amen. Yes, that's exactly what I mean. We get to unload on God because, see, I'm not supposed to be carrying around these burdens, these weights that beset me. No, I'm supposed to give them to him. And I thank God for prayer. And Jonah's one that was praying, amen? He prayed. God had him in a horrible circumstance. Now, Jonah got himself in that circumstance, but God had him there, and Jonah prayed. But see, praying is great, and we need prayer. But praying is not it. Sometimes we just got to get up off our knees, quit praying for souls, and go talk to them. Sometimes we got to get up and quit asking God to save our aunt, our uncle, our niece, or our brother, our sister, our cousin, our mother, our father, and we got to get up off our knees and go and talk to them about God. So Jonah's one that receives this word the second time to God. God tells him to arise. Prayer is vital to us, but at some point we've got to get up and go. That's his second part. God told him to arise, God told him to go. Jonah had a mission field that God intended for him, and that was the city of Nineveh. This was God's intention the whole time. Obviously, Jonah has finally come to that conclusion that he's going to do God's will. He's going to do what God wants him to do. So he's on his way there. He gets up. He goes. God has a mission field for all of us. We've got to get up and go. And then God told him to preach. God had a message for Jonah to share. And guess whose message it was? It wasn't Jonah's. Obviously, Jonah had no desire to go tell Nineveh anything, did he? No. So it wasn't Jonah's message that God wanted him to give. God wanted him to preach what he had for Nineveh. It was only God's word that was going to change Nineveh. It wasn't Jonah. It was only God's word. And you know, God has a message for us to share. You know, and I'm going to jump around in this message. I can't help it. I have attention problems, okay? But Jonah had a message from God to Nineveh. When he gets there, Jonah says, 40 days and you're going to be overthrown. Well, that's not a good message. I want a message that makes me feel better about myself, right? You're at the wrong place, okay? We can't feel better until we feel worse. God can't comfort those that haven't been convicted. Amen. But anyways, Jonah had a message from God. God said, I want you to preach what I want you to preach. And God has a message for us to share. It is a message of salvation, but you realize before you can tell someone about salvation, you got to get them lost. Amen. You know, it's not a popular thing to go talk about hell, is it? But guess what? Hell is real. Hell, the Bible says, hath enlarged itself. Why? I think in good part because the church isn't getting up and going out and preaching the message that God has for the people that he's sent us to our mission field. But Jonah was told to tell the people of Nineveh exactly what God wanted him to say. You know, I've got up here, every now and then God gives me a verse that I just really feel compelled to put up here. And I've had one up here for a while. The Bible says this in 1 Kings 22:14. And Micaiah said, as the Lord liveth, what the Lord saith unto me, that will I speak. And that is my desire every time I get up here. I only want to say what God wants me to say. I fail at that frequently. Again, I do have attention problems and things pop into my head sometimes. And I would apologize for that, but that would mean I'd be trying not to do it. And if I could try not to do it, I wouldn't. But God wanted Jonah to preach. God wants us to preach. He has a message for us to share. It's his message. You know, it's not what Larry says that's going to change anything. Amen. It's not what we have to say. When we go out to the mission field that God has given us here in Hancock County, this is our mission field, Faith Baptist Church, in McCordsville, in Fortville, in Pendleton, in Eden, in Maxwell, in Greenfield, in Shirley, in the areas surrounding us, this is our mission field. Now, I know not very many of us live in this mission field. Guess what? Jonah didn't live in his mission field either. Amen. But God has a mission field for us, and he has a message for us. And this message is the only thing that's going to help these people. It's the only thing that's going to change lives. But what I love is God does allow what he's put us through to be part of the message. And we'll get to that here in a second. Jonah had to reject his personal obstacles. Obviously, Jonah had some prejudice against the Ninevites, didn't he? We're not told exactly why it was that Jonah ran to Joppa and tried to go to Tarshish instead of going to Nineveh where God had told him. We don't know exactly why. We speculate that it was because of who the Ninevites were and their wickedness and their barbarian ways. And I believe he was. If Jonah was a Jew, then the Jews don't like anybody but Jews if you go around them. I've never seen more prejudice that is just rampant as when my wife and I went over to Israel, wasn't it, honey? I mean, just rampant prejudice. Now, if you have green, they don't care what you are as long as you have green. They like that, okay? But they don't look at people that aren't Hebrew as they do themselves. And so Jonah definitely had some prejudices as an obstacle. But he did overcome it and got up like God had told him to go and went to Nineveh, even though everything within him was against it. I know the inner struggles when God says, hey, get up and go give them a track, or get up and go ask them to church, or get up and go tell them what I've done in your life. I know the inner struggles. I have them too. I'll be at a gas pump and there'll be somebody next to me and I just want to mind my own business. I like minding my own business. I do. And I guess what? Are you listening? I like when other people mind their own business too. I do. I like it. I mean, I'll look at a guy and if we catch eyes, I'll go like it. That's it. That's good enough, right? That's man. That's man for, hey, how you doing? You doing all right? I'm doing all right. Are you doing all right? Yeah, I'm doing all right. That's it. All that right there. See, women, you don't get that, do you? That's men. I like it. I like minding my own business. I like for people to mind their own business. But see, I'm not here for my business. And so when God says to get up and go, we ought to do it. See, what I love, though, I mean, let's think about this now, okay? Let's think about Jonah for just a second, all right? Jonah has spent 3 days and nights in the belly of a whale, okay? Now, whales, especially in something that would be able to be inhabited, would be a mammal, okay? Well, I'm just using deductive reasoning and common sense here, folks, okay? And so if it's a mammal, then mammals have things in their stomach that help them digest the food that they intake. Now, obviously, Jonah was a little hard to digest, like some of the messages are, amen? But Jonah was being digested by this whale as he was there 3 days and three nights. How many of you love seafood? I don't know, what is wrong with you people? Seafood is amazing, okay? I mean, come on. But you know what I don't like? Old dead seafood that hasn't been cooked. You know why? It smells really, really bad. Amen? You know why water smells like fish? Because fish stink. Okay? Unless you cook them with garlic salt, then they're okay. But Jonah was in this belly of a whale. Guess what else was in that belly of a whale? Old dead fish. Rubbing up against him. Listen. You know, we just kind of just think, well, he was in the belly of a whale for 3 days. No, now listen, he was in the belly of a whale for 3 days being digested with everything else that was being digested for however long it had been there before he got there, okay? Trying to help us understand that Jonah, when he got spit up, the Bible says that the Lord had the whale vomit him up, okay? Vomit does not carry any good connotation that I know of, okay? I don't like vomit. I don't like vomiting. I don't like being around vomit. I'm a sympathetic vomiter, Miss Jenny, okay? If I see you upchuck, I'm going to upchuck, okay? It's just, I can't help it. It's just my biological makeup, all right? But there's nothing good about this. I just got done praying, God, and here I am laying a puddle of vomit. You don't think that crossed Jonah's mind? Then Jonah had a very long journey. I think it took about a week and a half for him to get from where he got spit up until where he finally got into Nineveh. And Nineveh was a great big old city. 3 days journey, the Bible said. Okay? That's walking. So, Jonah, now, I know he probably had a chance to take a bath or a shower before he got to Nineveh. But let me just tell you, I firmly believe that the digestive system of that whale did something to the outside of Jonah. Whether it messed with his pigmentation, the hair of his color, who knows? Maybe that's where redheads came from. I don't know. Just kidding. But Jonah did not look now like he did before he was in the belly of the whale. See, his sinful choices changed his appearance. But what I love, now, I want you to just, again, I'm going to jump around a little bit, okay? Jonah is now getting into Nineveh. He's had to overcome the obstacle that he has about the Ninevites. But let me just tell you, he probably thought he was pretty good looking before. I don't know if they had mirrors back then or if he just saw his reflection in the water. I guarantee you he wasn't so high on himself as he was before. But as he's going into Nineveh,
This is just what I picture. I picture as he's going to Nineveh, there's, first off, he's not from Nineveh, so he probably doesn't look and or dress like them, but he doesn't look or dress like anybody now, okay? He looks completely different. And the people of Nineveh are looking at this guy and like, okay, what happened to him? Now, these are barbarous people. These are barbarians. Let's just say that. Barbaric. Thank you. I love you. Very loquacious people. It's wonderful. Barbaric people that let a man that they did not know walk for a day into their city without asking what was going on. Now, see, I've been in areas that maybe someone of my dynamic or makeup should not be, and I've been asked questions as to why I was there, okay? And I've had to answer those questions, and sometimes it has upset people, and sometimes it has not. Never know. But Jonah is somewhere where he's not used to being, where people aren't used to seeing what he is, but they were so taken back by what he is, he was not messed with for a day's journey into Nineveh. Now, see, you guys didn't think about that, did you? See, you got to think about these things when you're reading these stories. There's so much more going on than what we just see with the words. But Jonah now has been given a message. He's been given a mission field. And God has had to change his mind about what he was doing and what he was doing it for. And so here he is. And God has taken the mess that Jonah made of his life and is about to use it for God's ministry. I love how God does that. See, we can come up with all kinds of excuses why we shouldn't do something, can't we? You can feel the Holy Spirit tugging on your heart to go and tell your friend over here about the Lord or to go and give this person a track. And you could think, well, Lord, they're not the same color as me. Or Lord, look at them. They got enough hardware where they probably get HBO. Or Lord, now, listen, that's not what I do. I don't wear those kind of clothes. I couldn't talk to somebody like that. And all these things that pop up in our minds and give us these reasons to not do what it is that God has called us to do, to not give the message to the people that God has told us to give it to. We have to reject these personal obstacles. What I love is Jonah did get into Nineveh. You know, the Bible says he traveled for a day into Nineveh before he started preaching. A day into Nineveh before he started preaching. But what I love is that Jonah didn't just get out to the outskirts of the city, send the message, say, spread it on, and take off. Because let me tell you something, I guarantee you that's what he wanted to do. Can I just say that God has got us here in Greenfield, in Hancock County. And Faith Baptist Church, we've got to get into Greenfield. I'm so thankful for everybody that came out on the Love Inc. Church Expo and the 5K. We had a good crowd of our church there, and it was wonderful. Now, I wish there had been more people that didn't go to church there. It was cold, and a lot of people didn't go out, but I appreciate those that went out and did something, gave of their time, went out and got into Greenfield. And folks, that's something we need to do. And like I said, I know a lot of us don't live here, but you know, we talked Wednesday night about that sacrifice of time. We ought to be willing to sacrifice our time to do what God has called us to do. But Jonah got into there and he started preaching God's word. 40 days you have before God overthrows the city. I believe Jonah cried this with great either conviction or condemnation, one or the other. There was passion in his voice. And he pronounced God's word. You know, I'm still not sure which one it was that Jonah had, whether it was with great conviction that he cried to the people of Nineveh, or whether it was with great condemnation. As someone who preaches God's word, I have to be very careful that if I do preach condemnation, that there's conviction with it. Amen? That's for me. That's not for you guys. Tell them pastor said hi. I hate it when my phone rings and I'm in the middle of preaching. It's horrible. Jonah was preaching with passion, though, and he pronounced God's word. What's amazing to me, though, is here these people are, and the Bible says that they believed God.
They believed God. Now, we're not going to get into chapter 4 this morning. We're going to get into it tonight. But the Bible says that there was 120,000 people there in Nineveh. And that from the greatest to the least, they believed God. It tells me that there was something about Jonah's message and something about what Jonah looked like that caused them to believe that God was real and that God was serious and that they needed to get serious. But they believed God. They proclaimed a fast. I hate fasting. You know why? Because it means I don't eat. Okay? I don't like fasting. But sometimes when you got to get yourself where you need to be, you got to tell this old flesh it doesn't get what it wants. The people of Nineveh proclaimed a fast. They put off their clothing and put on sackcloth. The Bible says even the king took off his royal things, laid them aside, and put on sackcloth. Now, I don't know what y'all think about when you think of sackcloth. I don't think of a Walmart bag, okay? I'm glad they didn't have Walmart bags. That would have not covered much. But I think of like a burlap sack. Y'all remember burlap sacks? You don't get them in potato bags or nothing like that anymore, but a burlap sack is, it's not comfortable. It's itchy. This is what I picture of them putting on is something that was not comfortable. They put away their comfort. They put away their clothing and they humbled themselves. But more importantly, you know what they did? The Bible says they put away their wickedness. They put away their wickedness. They put away the things, the barbaric things that they did. You know what this is? This is the very definition of repentance. You know why they did it? They said, peradventure, who knows, but maybe God will turn away from his wrath. Jonah wasn't saying 40 days and you're going to be overthrown unless you repent. That was not Jonah's message. This is not what the people of Nineveh were hearing. They were simply hearing that God is done with you. God is going to throw your city away. You don't think they'd heard about Sodom and Gomorrah some years ago? Nineveh was actually founded by a man that was seeking after God. How did they know to fast? How did they know to put off their wickedness and to put on sackcloth and sit in ashes? How did they know to do these things? I believe they had a history of being a godly nation, but they had turned their back on God and God wanted to get their attention. Now, what is amazing is they did this whether God was going to repent of his wrath or not. You know, it's real easy to tell God you're sorry because you're thinking of how good he's going to be to you for how sorry you are. It's real easy to repent when you know that what you're going to get is goodness. Amen? But what if there's no guarantee of the goodness? What if God is never going to show you his love again? Would you still be willing to do whatever you had to do to repent? You understand, Jonah said 40 days, and this word spread throughout Nineveh. I don't know how many days it took, but I'm going to say, with that many people and that big of a city as it was, about 60 miles wide, I'm going to say that they probably spread pretty quick. That not just that Jonah would go around and continue to preach, but these folks decided that they needed to turn to God. And within, I would say, at the very most, 20 days, I would say that from the greatest to the least, they had taken off their fancy clothes or their favorite clothes and they'd put on something uncomfortable. They were sitting in ashes, covering themselves with ashes. This is an act of humility in the Eastern countries back then. This is what they did to humble themselves. They didn't eat. They wouldn't even work. They wouldn't even work. No feeding of the animals. No watering. No food, no water. They were taking God's message seriously. They were taking repentance seriously. And what I love is the Bible verse that we have up there. And God saw their works. Now, wait a second. We're not works-based. What do you mean God saw their works? But you know what produced those works?
Just like the Bible says in James, you show me your faith without your works, I'll show you my faith with my works. They believed that God would be merciful. They believed that God would be gracious. They believed that God would turn his fierce anger from them to the point that they were going to repent or bust. God respected the works of their repentance. God noticed their heart. You know, there's been times in my life where I thought, well, I'll just repent until it gets better. Fake it till you make it, right? I'll just repent until it gets better. That wasn't the attitude of the Ninevites, and I don't think that's the kind of attitude God is looking for when he's looking for a repentant heart. They fasted for close to 40 days, some of them, while forsaking their clothing and their comfort. So God repented of his judgment to Nineveh. He chose to accept their turning to him. They didn't just turn from their wickedness. They weren't just sitting in sackcloth hoping for the best. They were praying. They were praying. They were drawing nigh to God. And the Bible says if you'll draw nigh to him, he'll draw nigh to you. And so God, who had told Jonah he was going to give up on Nineveh, wasn't really willing to give up on Nineveh. It wasn't any longer an option. As I said, God has given us a mission field. Hancock County is the mission field of Faith Baptist Church. And while I will say this, someone that has lived in the inner city for years and in some pretty rough neighborhoods and have knocked on doors. I mean, Brother Mark, the neighborhood that I used to knock on doors for the bus ministry. That's what I was saying. Somebody with my dynamic really sticks out. Okay. And I've been asked, what are you doing here? And for fear of life, I've even said, I'm here on my father's business. That'll put somebody on their heels like, what? I've been in some rough places. And I can say this. I've had doors slammed on me. I've had police called on me. I've had people very angry that I was there. All these different things. But here in Greenfield, it's just not the same. Everybody's nice out here. They really are. I mean, they have the nicest way of saying, I'll never come to your church. Okay? That's those that aren't going to church, but a lot of people go to church here in Greenfield. We knock on doors. And you know, it's real easy to knock on a door and say, hey, I'm from Faith Baptist Church and just wanted to invite you to church today. Our church is right over here on Maxwell and we'd love to have you come. And I'll ask this question, do you go to church anywhere? And some of them will say yes. And you know what I like to do? Well, that's a good enough answer for me, and I'll sometimes just walk away. But you know what Hancock County needs? They need to realize that going to church doesn't save you. They need to realize that being a member of a church doesn't matter if you're not born again. They need to realize that even as nice as they are, they're wicked, just like I'm wicked. And they need to realize that God has a message for them. They need to realize that God loves them. But see, how are they going to realize? The Bible says, how will they know without a preacher? And guess what? I know you're going to, ooh, I'm off the hook, I'm not a preacher. Oh, if you're a child of God, you're a preacher. If you're a child of God, you've been given a message. You've been given a mission field. And I know what you're saying. Pastor, I'm just too big of a mess to be used by God. Well, I'd suggest you just go ahead and knock that little devil off your shoulder that's been lying to you. I love that God uses exactly who I am to glorify him. Exactly who I used to be. Sometimes I don't think about things as I'm saying them. Because I am not a drug addict anymore. I'm not an addict of any kind anymore other than maybe donuts, okay? And I'm working on that. I'm not an angry person like I used to be. Now, I do get angry, okay? God's to help me with that. And we're actually going to address that tonight. But not your anger, my anger, okay? I'm done talking to you guys tonight. It's about me tonight. So. But God has got all this that he wants for us, and we convince ourselves that we're too far gone, or God really can't use me. If God can use a guy that was in the belly of a whale for 3 days and three nights, who hated the people that he was talking to, what if I was somebody who just fell in love with God and allowed God to love people through me? What could God do with that? What could God do with somebody who was just completely submitted to what he wanted them to do? No matter their history, no matter how far gone they might have been, no matter how far gone they might be right now, God wants to use us. God wants to use you. And he'll take you just like you are right now. You know, I grew up in church. And so when I got away from God, actually I wasn't saved, but when I got saved, I figured, well, I know how to look and act like a Christian. I can do it. Do it. You know how much God used me then? Zero. Goose egg. Because I wasn't submitted to him. I wasn't doing things for him. I was just putting on a show. But man, when I just realized how big of a mess I was, what a moron I was. Pastor, you calling us morons? No, I'm not. I'm calling myself a moron. Now, I do agree that most people are a lot like me. Now, I'll say that. But when we decide to do things our way or try and argue with God about what it is that he wants us to do, the Bible has a word for that. The Bible calls that a fool. And I guarantee you, if you look up fool in a thesaurus, moron's going to be there with it, okay? But God wants to use me, regardless of how bad things have gotten, regardless of where I've been. And amazingly, he wants to use me right where I'm at. You know, maybe Jonah took a shower or a bath before he got to Nineveh. Maybe he didn't. Maybe he didn't. But God used him, problems and all. And God can use you, problems and all. And you know what? We get this mindset, and that's why I've kind of chosen this question. What if giving up isn't an option? We get this mindset that, what's the use? You know what that is? That's giving up. Well, what's the use? Seriously, what can I do? What can I do? And I'm so glad that God doesn't give up on us. And I love telling people that feel like they've gone too far, telling people that they feel like they can't do anything for God, telling people that have believed the lie from their flesh or from the devil that they are just too messed up for God. I like saying this: God hasn't given up on you yet. If there's breath in your lungs, he's not done with you. And yeah, maybe you've had to spend some time in a dark place, but God's ready to allow you to let that dark place let a little light in. That's what Jonah did when he's in that dark belly. Let me tell you, there was no light. There wasn't any electricity. He didn't have an iPhone with a flashlight on it there in that belly. Well, it was dark. We talked about it a couple weeks ago, full of torments for him. The Holy Spirit, or Jesus Christ, even compared it to hell. God wants to use us. And you know, Nineveh, these wicked, barbaric people, believed God's word and saw great revival break out in their city simply because they believed God's word. Why is it that we will spend countless service after hearing God's word time and time again? And will not turn away from our wickedness. And will not give up our comfort. Will not give up the things that we like to simply seek repentance with a God that loves us enough to never give up. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. You stand with me. The invitation song is Just As I Am. Are you willing to let God use you? I know we didn't preach a salvation message today, but Nineveh came to salvation that day. In this 40 days that Jonah was preaching, where are you at right now? Maybe you're kind of where Jonah was at in that belly of the whale. You're in a horrible circumstance. You're in a rough situation. Can I tell you, Jonah came to the conclusion that God had him there to get his attention. Maybe God's got you right where you're at because he wants to get your attention.